Ethan was already introduced at large. He spoke beautifully before, so I'm not going to introduce him again. Just a word about myself. My name is Michael Arendt. I am the diplomatic correspondent of the Times of Israel. I usually cover politics and diplomacy, and my secret love of the world and issues of diaspora-Israel relations. I myself was born in Germany, studied in the States, and am a journalist of Israel since 2008. I work for Haaretz, and now I'm with the Times of Israel, media sponsor of this
conversation.
for a different panel, Israeli media landscape is for a different panel. Some of the heavy issues of the changing nature of Israel diaspora relations we've discussed, and we'll come back to them, and I very, very soon want to open it up to your questions. But I also want to start on a completely different note, just, you know, to ease in. Gidi Ginstein was, you know, only introduced as the founder and president of the Ehud Institute, and that's of course his main occupation. But he also used to be a former senior peace negotiator. He was part of Ehud Barak's mission to Camp David. And if I'm not mistaken, you would even save the former prime minister's life by extracting a peanut from his lungs, is that correct?
Yes.
So, since you are in...
Guilty of charge.
So, since you are... since, you know, Ehud Barak...
If you guys are bored and you want to transition to something else, I can... all of us can exercise today some Heimlich with lunch.
It's always useful.
Very useful. And,
but no, but seriously now, Ehud Barak again is making headlines in Israel, and as somebody who worked with him closely, I just wanted to, you know, ask you, I can't get out of my skin as a journalist, I just have to ask him, what is going on with Ehud Barak? He's again making headlines, he's commenting on current affairs, and there were there was a huge billboard in central Tel Aviv the other day. Barak, come back and save us. Bibi is destroying the country. And nobody knew who paid for it, and Barak said, I have no intention to come back to political life, but it's hard not to get the impression that he wants to come back. So, Gidi, you know, this is completely unrelated, but I need to ask you, is your former boss coming back?
He's never gone. Well, last time I spoke to him, he also pledged, way before his campaign, that he's never going back into politics again. And he loves, at least that's what he says, he loves the ability to speak about the condition of Israel in a very uninhibited way, that he's not driven by all sorts of political considerations and so on. So, last I spoke to him, which was actually a few months ago, and he gave me attention back to politics. But what I can tell you three things about Ehud Barak. The first is that he is one of the most intelligent and sophisticated people that have ever been in the Israeli democracy. He's extremely intelligent, which is sometimes detriment, because he always plans like 15 moves. And he has this very convoluted way in which he will go one way and things will happen another way, and there will be a backlash and some unintended consequences, which of course he anticipates, and they're not really unintended, etc., etc. So this whole thing, and those moves are often too complicated for the messiness of politics.
Bottom line,
the last I heard, he has no intention of going back to politics, but if he does, then it will be another one of these, I think, Elbach, sophisticated, complicated moves that may or may not work out, but he's, to his credit, I would say that he's really one of the most thoughtful people you could talk to about the condition, direction of Israel, state of Israel, and that.
So let's talk about it. Let's come to the original subject of this talk, which is really...
By the way, let me just say that I think the only politician today that is at Barak's, Ehud Barak's level in terms of education and intellectual capabilities is Benjamin Netanyahu.
Repeat?
It's Benjamin Netanyahu.
Yeah.
And their relationship, I think, is interesting from that perspective, because really these are two people who understand history, understand economics, understand geopolitics, and the relationship between them is a story in and of itself.
We can come back later, you know, we're going to open it very fairly soon after questions, so if you want to come back to peace negotiating questions, we have an expert here on peace negotiations. But we've gathered here to talk about the Jewish world, and you said a sentence before the panel that you've already said in an interview with Alex in 2014 that there's never been a better time to be a Jew. And then the second part of that quote, and I wrote it down here, is your reasoning for that. And you said at the time, it would have been inconceivable a decade ago that an Israeli PM would defy the will of the American president. Today it is possible because our power is unprecedented. Right. That is quite a sentence. Our power is unprecedented. Now that you have, now that the Iran deal is behind us and we had the signing of the MOU, would you still say the same sentence in that way?
Yes, but my statement is not about a condition that could change from 2014 to 2016 or at that time span. I'm looking at a few basic parameters that all of the each and every one of them separately is unprecedented, and together this combination is exponential in many ways. So first of all, the state of Israel. Obviously, the state of Israel is we've never had it so good. All of our enemies, you know, when I was in the military, whoever served here in the military, we all heard about the Egyptian threat, the Syrian threat, they're all gone. Iraq was a major army that we were looking at, it's gone, you know? So a lot of our enemies are gone. There is no existential threat today to the state of Israel.
What about for Iran, which is?
Iran is an emerging threat, but not right now. And second, look, even Colin Powell just was quoted recently that Israel has 200 nuclear warheads targeted at Iran. Okay? So Iran is a long way from posing an existential threat to Israel. So first of all, I just want us to acknowledge that we are in Israel in the best possible condition, the best condition in our history. Our macroeconomic performance is really outstanding and has improved. It used to be that when you come to America, infrastructure-wise, you would go up. Today, you go down. Today, when you travel across the amazing network of roads and then the growing network of trains and so on in Israel, it's far more advanced than America, what we have in America. The water systems in Israel are much more advanced than America. So multiple conditions. The death ratio of Israel is now way under OECD average. So yes, we have a lot of problems, but really it's the best condition we've been. At the same time, the North American Jewish community is also in a position of unprecedented power. Actually, as an Israeli who's been living in America, I actually think that the North American Jewish community is even in a state of, there's a saying in Hebrew, it's one thing to be in the water, it's another thing to be from the springboard. American Jews, I feel, are exercising their influence on this country in very, very blatant, aggressive ways. Today, there's a lot of confidence in this community, and tremendous influence of the American Jewish community on the United States of America. Totally disproportionate representation of Jews within the elite circles of this country, whether in politics, finance, banking, economics, and
so on. Like the particle of the Elephant Line.
Yeah.
What did you say? Over.
I'm not over. Look, over representation is clear. You look. Look at the numbers. You know, where Jews are less than 2% of the population here. Look at our representation in Congress. Look at our representation around the president. Look at our representation in the senior positions in the government. Look at the Jewish representation in the elite of the financial circles, of the technological circles, entertainment. Okay. Academia here. So it's a tremendous, tremendous achievement. By the way, Jews have been very, very successful in other diasporas in history, in Alexandria, in Mesopotamia, in Poland, in Germany, in Spain, etc., etc. So that's the second piece. The third thing is the world of Torah, which most of us here in the room are probably not religious Jews, but the world of Torah is also more developed than ever before. There was never so many people and so many resources available for the study of Torah, for the development of the Torah, of, you know, expanding of the Torah, of dealing with Jewish life and innovating around Jewish life. And then when you look at all the other Jews, so we spoke about 40% of Jews in America, 40% of Jews in Israel, the remaining 20% of the Jews, where are they? They're not under oppression in some third world countries. They're in Canada, they're in Australia, they're in South Africa, which is a whole story in and of itself. They're in Europe, and so on. So South Africa, you're South African Jews, right? 60,000 Jews, roughly speaking. 0.1% of the population, 65 million South Africans. 23 of the 100 wealthiest families in South Africa are Jewish.
It used to be
one. What? So, just look at that.
It's all relative.
It's all relative, but just look at what's happening. So, the condition is we are in an excellent situation in terms of the Jewish people. My argument is that that success poses challenges. That's what I was trying to say from the stage, and we can maybe elaborate here. There are challenges that come with power.
Right, so do you see this trajectory continuing in a positive way?
It's very hard to say, because when you throw a ball and the ball, you know, goes up in the air, it goes up and up and up and up. At some point, there is this moment of dynamic rest, and then it comes down. We don't know when the peak will be. And I think that we shouldn't take for granted what we have now. I do see key challenges emerging for our people that emanate from the fact that we're losing our edge, okay? We used to be the only universally educated society.
Yep.
That's no longer the case. We used to be the only truly global society in the world. That's been diminished, or that's been eroded as well. We used to be spread out in multiple countries. Today we're hyper-concentrated in two nations, in the state of Israel and the United States of America. In terms, whoever comes a little bit from the world of networks understand that hyper-concentration makes a network more vulnerable, not stronger. So
let me quickly interject here and then we'll come back to that. Even though I want to focus this on North American and Israeli Jews, but for example, French Jewry, is there a future for these medium-sized communities such as in South Africa, France, Germany, even Britain to some extent?
Well, first of all, what we need to remember in Jewish history is the center of gravity of the Jewish people keeps shifting. Okay? The Jews are never stable. They're always in motion, as a people. So one of my slight point of disagreements of what was presented earlier is that in 1882, you know, there are, I think, 10 million Jews in Europe. And that's when the crisis, the big crisis of European Jewry began to emerge, first in the East and then in the West, and so on. So from that crisis, look what happened. A fraction went to the land of Israel, which is what Danny Gord is describing. Where did most Jews go? South African Jewry, but that's not most. Most Jews came to America.
Yeah.
In 1880, there are 250,000 American Jews. By 1931, 39, 4 million American Jews. So the Jewish community in America grew 16-fold in the span of 60 years. And then during that period, South American Jewish Jewry grew, right? Jews went to Venezuela, to Brazil, to Argentina, to Mexico, and so on. South Africa Jewry emerged, Australian Jewry emerged, and so on. My point is, we are in constant movement. That movement continues today. And we don't know which small Jewish community, which presently small Jewish community may become within decades or a century one of the leading Jewish communities in the world. One of the most interesting phenomena is that the fastest growing, per capita basis, fastest growing Jewish communities in the world today are where?
Berlin.
No. In the Far East. In Hong Kong, I'm talking on a per capita basis, so very low starting point. But explosive growth in the Jewish community in Hong Kong, in Beijing,
in Shenzhen,
Shenzhen.
Are these establishing communities, or is it a sort of business commuter community?
It doesn't matter how it begins. The Jews started coming, and then there is a shul, and then there is a mikveh, and then there is a school. You know, just like the Dire Straits song. Dire Straits, you know the song? Then came the churches, then came the school. Yes, exactly. So you know, what we know about Jewish communities, which is really fascinating, is that every Jewish community around the world has the same core set of institutions. You go to Buenos Aires, you go to Paris, you come here, you go to Hong Kong, you find the same core set of institutions. You find synagogues and mikvehs, and a committee of the community, which you in America call federation. And you find the fund, you find the school, and so on. But not two Jewish communities are alike. My point is that what's happening here in America is really remarkable, but we don't know whether this is the peak of the development of American Jewry. Maybe it will go higher, and maybe it will begin to decline. But if and when it declines, other communities will begin to rise, and who knows what will happen in Europe. I'm not optimistic about the future of Europe. But what we know...
What you said is really provocative and quite shocking, almost saying, you're basically positing that it could be that American Jewry is in decline right now?
It could be that American Jewry is peaking. For a few reasons. First of all, numbers. We've not been growing in numbers. Very high level of assimilation.
Right.
A lot of internal conflict that is happening here. So no one knows, but there are enough reasons to be worried. And the beauty is of our system, when I say system, I'm talking about Jewish society, is that if over here we are worried, over there you have leaders and societal entrepreneurs who are already tackling these issues. So they could be a rabbi in Tampa, Florida, or a community organizer in New York, or a JCC in Palo Alto. But someone out there is already beginning to tackle these issues. And that's the beautiful dynamics of the Jewish people. We are really a free market of ideas, of innovations, of institutions that are competing with each other all the time. And that's the secret of our success. So I cannot tell you if you've already peaked. I can't tell you it's unprecedented. We may go higher or not, no one knows. But
you were speaking about concentration, and you were describing the two poles, and it's clearly the case, there are two poles of Jewish life right now, which is in Israel and the United States. Don't you think it's sort of common wisdom that these poles are in the meantime growing and smaller communities are being absorbed into the larger communities, with Venezuelan Jews coming to the United States? With French Jews going or either to Canada or to Israel.
I think one of the points where Zionism is wrong is assuming that the loyalty of Jews and Israeli Jews to Israel is unconditional. Zionism has to wake up every day to win again the loyalty of Jews to Israel. We shouldn't take it for granted. And if Israel fails the Jewish people, Jews will gravitate out of Israel. It may take decades, it may take a century, but Jews will gravitate outside of Israel.
Are you speaking all Jews or specifically Israeli Jews?
Yes.
So,
and other, it can take two forms. Israeli Jews leaving Israel, and the diaspora Jews disengaging from Israel.
Right.
So what's your thought on what sociologists call the distancing hypothesis?
I think it's a very... moderate form of describing what is actually happening. The distancing between the Israel and the diaspora. What I, unfortunately, our team has been doing a lot of research on this issue over the last year, and I can say that what we're seeing is more a rupture than a distancing. And we're seeing two big coalitions that are clashing now. One coalition has a strong anchor within the Israeli left that works with liberal Jews, works with primarily American liberals, non-Jews. And that's one coalition. And the other coalition is the Israeli right with Orthodox Jews, with Christian evangelists, with Republicans here. And those two coalitions are beginning to clash against Israel. So for example, our team did a lot of work in trying to understand the challenge of the delegitimization of Israel and the BDS movement. So really, ten years ago, when you saw a Jew on the other side, it was usually really sort of an anti-Jewish Jew.
Right.
You know, there's always been a phenomenon in our people of Jews that turned against the Jewish people. You know, that one of the commanders of the Roman Legion that destroyed Jerusalem was Jewish. You know, once some of the heads of the persecution of Jews under the Inquisition were Jewish. And then many of the leaders of the Communist Party who, you know, were Jews. So that phenomena existed, and these are the people we saw on the other side. Today you see legitimate Jews as part of the BDS movement, and you see Israelis who come from sometimes even a Zionist narrative, who support and are part of the BDS movement. So what I'm saying is that unfortunately, this theory of distancing is a very, very generous, if you wish, moderate way to describe what is actually happening. What's happening is something much more aggressive, where every institution, every event is a battlefield.
And how much of a threat is there really?
I think it's a huge threat to Israel for two reasons. First of all, the support of the diaspora Jews to Israel has been a key to the national security of the state of Israel. But beyond that, you know, the mission of Israel, as I understand it, is to be the nation state of the Jewish people. So if a growing number of Jews actually express disinterest in Zionism and in Israel, it's a problem for Israel. Now, we have to remember that for most of the 20th century, Zionism was not the majority movement in the Jewish people. Zionism began to actually lead the Jewish people and enjoy the support of the majority of Jews, not all of Jews, roughly speaking, in 1967. From 48, it inclines, it inclines. 67 is the moment where many, many Jews around the world become Zionists. And that peak continues until roughly 1982. 1982, the first Lebanon War, is when you look back, you couldn't see it then. But when you look back, the first Lebanon War is the moment in which we begin to see the first serious doubts among leading Jews, who are even leaders within the Jewish community, who used to be pro-Israel, are beginning to ask tough questions about Israel. So from 1982, we begin this process of erosion, and that means that we are already almost 35 years into the process.
Now, at the panels before, which were really fascinating, you know, we superficially talked about these two issues that are the main bones of contention, if you will, between Israel and the diaspora community, which are, as Daniel Gores put it, occupation and the rabbinate. So now let's talk about these two. First of all, the rabbinate. What's the solution to that? Because it seems that the Israeli leadership is unwilling to engage with the diaspora Jewry. They just say, and I can tell you from my own experience, Israeli Jewish leaders say that's the reality in this country. And if American Jews want to change it, they need to come here and vote, and then the coalition mathematics will look different. In the meantime, I'm not willing to make an effort to change it because that's the reality. So it seems like that.
Look, I think this is the one area where Zionism is really compromising the Jewish people, and it's very, very serious. Because one of the secrets of the, I mentioned earlier, the resilience, recurring prosperity and leadership of the Jewish people is that you don't have a pope.
Right.
And no one's in charge. So how does the Jewish people evolve? It evolves through competition among religious and community leaders. Okay, so if you could be a community, let's say that this is a network of communities, and you're a religious leader over here, a community leader over here, and I'm over there, I'm beginning to develop my ideas, and he or she are beginning to develop their ideas. And if whoever has better ideas, these ideas will eventually proliferate around the Jewish world and basically change the direction of the Jewish people. So what begins as innovation turns into, if it proves itself, it turns into a custom and then law. And no one's in charge. And I could decide to
to convert. I could in one community I could establish the benchmark for conversion over here, and another rabbi could establish the benchmark for conversion over there, and no one, there is no mechanism that will decide between those two rabbis.
Times
have changed. And this is why the state of Israel is introducing rigidity in the place where there has always been flexibility. Mm-hmm. And it's not just the rabbin. It's legislation on kashrut, it's legislation on Shabbat, on holidays, and so on. Now,
but it's a function of democracy.
It's a function of democracy. But if it, my argument is.
Is it really?
I'm sorry.
Well, is it really?
I would argue that it's a question of coalition arithmetic.
And you're right, but my argument is that a Jewish parliament should know what are the boundaries of power. And this is an area where you should not legislate. They should not legislate. The Knesset should not legislate on issues that throughout history have been regulated through the competition among rabbis. And I think that this is an area where the Israeli parliament is overreaching into Jewish society and therefore compromising processes that have proven it themselves over centuries and centuries. And really, in this space, I think that we Israelis are way overconfident in thinking that we have invented over the last 60-something years a mechanism that is superior to what has worked for 26th centuries.
Well, if I understand you correctly, you're arguing for a sort of a separation of church and state in a certain sense.
It's another great point. I don't think that in Judaism you can separate between church and state.
But that's what you just argued.
I'm arguing about legislative restraint. The Knesset should not legislate. These are areas where there should not be legislation. This is an area where rabbis and communities should and could be allowed to form their own ways, and then people will gravitate in the direction of one rabbi.
I understand, and personally I appreciate that idea of sort of religion as a marketplace of ideas, but let me drag you back into the dirty world of politics that I deal with on a daily basis. At the end of the day, if Netanyahu wants to have a stable coalition,
right,
he needs to have the support of certain parties, and for them this is really important, and they will just disagree with you because they, and why? Because they can.
Of course.
And that's just how the system is.
So I think we're now going, we could actually discuss the dynamics of Israeli politics, but I think the conversation here is about what's happening in the Jewish world. So what's happening in the Jewish world is we're asking from non-Orthodox religious leaders and religious communities to accept the fact that their way is not accepted in Israel, nonetheless remain very supportive of Israel. And
so far the fact. Yeah.
What's your opinion? Can you go back to the issue that you brought up about separation of church and state? Why would it philosophically inherently be against Zionism if there was a separation?
Because Judaism, the idea of Judaism is that you bring Judaism into life through the way you live. Judaism manifests itself through the way you live your life. Okay? So through the way an individual lives their life, a family lives their life, a community lives their life. So because Judaism is basically an enterprise of society building, okay, in the diaspora, that process of society building was, you know, we legislated internally and we created our own institutions and people could either join or leave. And many left and many stayed, right? In Israel, you know, a lot of the areas require legislation. So let me give you a simple example. What is the National Day of Rest? Friday, Saturday, or Sunday? Friday according to Islam, Saturday according to the Jews, Sunday according to Christianity. You gotta make a choice. Jewish holidays, are they national holidays or not? I say yes. So, and I could give you many other examples where basically you can, I believe you cannot separate between Judaism as a religion and Judaism and the national project of Judaism. That being said, there are certain areas that really relate to the personal status.
where I think that the fact that the Knesset is legislating on is compromising. So even if the Knesset is legislating, I want to give you an example of a middle ground that could have allowed much more flexibility in the system. You know, today in Israel, a person or a family has to be married with the local rabbi. So if I live in Tel Aviv, I have to be married by the rabbi of Tel Aviv.
It was changed recently.
No, it wasn't. That's what they wanted, and I thought it was a great idea. I don't think so. I don't think so. It was passed, but if it was passed and I missed it, then it's great. But the idea was that you could choose. Okay, so I don't necessarily need to be married by the rabbi of my community. I can go to a next door community and get married there. That already creates what?
Competition.
Yes, it creates competition. It creates a marketplace of ideas, and you could choose your rabbi, and so on. Look, there are some holidays in Israel that many secular Jews resent. The most observed holiday in Israel is Yom Kippur.
Right.
Right? There's no legislation on Yom Kippur. There's nothing that legislates in Israel that you cannot drive your car on Yom Kippur. People don't drive their car. My perspective is, and I'm saying this as a secular, it's counterproductive for Judaism to legislate on these religious issues.
But the same rationale applied to the idea of Israel as a Jewish state.
So Israel as a Jewish state.
It's a whole different question. Do you mind if you come back to that a bit later? Because I do want to come back. I want to stay on this topic for a moment and just ask for how to remedy that, because that's what we came together here to discuss. Right, you have these two major parts of the Jewish people, roughly half in Israel, roughly half in the United States, and they're drifting apart, and two of the main modes of contention we are discussing it. And it's one thing to analyze it, and it's the second to propose strategies to combat it. And this is sort of your daily bread, so I'm really curious to hear, how do you counter this trend?
Well, first of all, I'm not sure I have answer how to deal with all of it, but what I can tell you is that I believe that with a different electoral system, without getting into
right.
too much, you could be in a situation where the position of the religious parties is not as powerful. It's still, they will still have power, and they should have power. There are 10-15% of the population. They deserve at least 10-15% of the influence in the political system. We're talking here about an overreach into the life of non-Orthodox people. And by the way, actually, those of you that know what's going on in Israel, I want to say that in many, many ways, the Orthodox community in Israel has been much more restrained in using its political power in the last years compared to the 1980s. In the 1990s. So they've actually become more sort of restrained, meaning if the state allows them to live their lives within their communities, they are now much more hesitant in overreaching and imposing their way on the non-Orthodox population in Israel. So I think that they are also growing into understanding the societal dynamics and gender balance.
So do you think that this major crisis that we're facing again and again with the Western Wall and with conversions, do you think at some point this is going to solve itself, or
I don't think it will solve itself, but I do think that the Western Wall is a beautiful question, and it's a question that actually highlights. It's another question or another issue that highlights what to me is the meta question of Israel in the seventh or eighth decade, soon eighth decade of its existence, which is what does it mean to be the nation state of the Jewish people? And in this case, who owns the Western Wall? Right? There's the Western Wall there. Who does it belong to? Is it an asset of the Jewish people, where the government of Israel is a custodian? Okay? Is it an asset of the government of Israel? Or is it an asset of the little non-profit that runs it? My view is, it's an asset of the Jewish people. The government of Israel is the custodian.
Okay? The reality is
that the state of Israel does whatever it wants.
Exactly. And I think it's a problem. But look, I know that you're actually pushing me for the technical solutions, and I think it's a very valid point. At the same time, I would say that part of what eventually drives legislation is ideas. Ideas in the public sphere, over time translating to legislation and regulation, policies and budgets and so on. And I believe that Israelis have not yet begun to really embrace the notion that we are today the 400-pound gorilla of the Jewish people, and that comes with responsibility. So the beginning, the turning point, I believe, was Birthright Israel. It was actually the first major project. Yeah, we were there together. it was the first major project where the government of Israel started basically injecting resources into affluent communities outside of Israel. And that was the turning point in 1995. But I think we still have ways to go in terms of understanding the implications of being the nation state of the Jewish people in the 21st century. And the Wailing Wall, what's happening in the Kotel, is one issue that brings to the surface these dynamics. And I believe that the compromise that Sharansky offered is a compromise that reflects a deep understanding of the role of the state of Israel. And many of the criticism on his compromise came from people who do not appreciate the role of the state of Israel vis-a-vis the Jewish people. They still look at it from the old paradigm of, you know, rich uncle, poor nephew, blood for money, which means we give our blood, you give your money, and so on.
I see there are a couple of questions. I want to ask one more question myself, and then I want to open it up to the audience, because I really would like to discuss BDS. You mentioned it briefly before, and one question that I always raise with discussing BDS is that we talk so much about BDS as if this is sort of the new specter that should frighten us all. And I wonder whether BDS is not being inflated by us talking about it so much. It is a marginal phenomenon. There are state legislators all across the United States, I think even here in California, that basically outlaw BDS. And the people who are actually boycotting Israeli products, it's minimal. It's really negligible. So why do we not just, you know, take the air out of this big balloon and just, you know, recognize that there are always people who will have something to complain about and want to boycott the Israel, but it's in no way as threat to Israel.
So I think that you've actually expressed a very Israeli perspective on this issue, which also the Prime Minister expressed. You're in very good company. Because the Prime Minister just a few weeks ago went to the Knesset and declared victory on BDS. And in a certain way, he is right. I happen to disagree, but there is one interpretation where the Prime Minister is right and you're right, which is, if you look at BDS and you measure BDS by the number of successful attempts to drive boycotts, divestment, and sanctions on Israel, the number of attempts that actually succeeded, we have defeated most of these attempts, and therefore we can declare victory. And not only that we have declared victory, we're beginning to see a decline in the number of BDS initiatives around the country. So from that perspective, the Prime Minister is right in the argument. But there's also another perspective, which I'd like to speak about. So the BDS is one strategy of the delegitimization of Israel. What is the delegitimization of Israel? It's the singular negation of the right of the state of Israel to exist and of the right of the Jewish people to self-determination.
Right.
It comes in the form of a systemic, meaning the whole system, a systematic, meaning very organized, assault on the political, economic, and security model of the state of Israel. It is inspired by what happened in South Africa, white South Africa, Soviet Union, and so on.
This is the denaturalization.
I just very provocatively want to interrupt you here and just contest that notion. BDS, if I understand it correctly, back in South Africa and even in the case of Israel, doesn't, or at least claims not to undermine the existence of the state of Israel, just wants to effect a certain change in policies. The BDS doesn't say we want the state of Israel to cease to exist.
This is where we really disagree. So let me just say that if this is the delegitimization of Israel, there have been six recognized strategies of delegitimizing Israel. BDS is one strategy for delegitimizing Israel. There are five other strategies. It happens in the media, it happens in international organizations like the UN, it happens through policies and diplomatic motions by countries, it happens through mega events like, you know, like the Gaza Flotilla. Remember the Gaza Flotilla?
Yeah.
And it happens through law firm, using legal measures. So BDS is one strategy. And BDS started to rise when the mega events began to decline. So in 2010, there was less BDS, there was more, you know, Gaza Flotilla, and then there was another flotilla that never sailed, and they wanted to do, so they wanted to do these big, big events. Israel circumvented them, boats started sinking, and so on, all over the world, and then suddenly all that was frustrated. So that's when you saw the rise of BDS, and I can tell you for sure, when we frustrate BDS, delegitimization will come in a new form, and we're beginning to see the new form of BDS in this country, which is through semi-violent disruptions of pro-Israel related activities. It's already beginning to rise. You see one number declining, another number rising. Now, when you look at the people involved in BDS, there are basically, it's a spectrum, but let me speak about three groups. The delegitimizers, the harsh critics, and what we call the long tail, the soft critics. The delegitimizers are anti-Semitic, modern day, it's modern day anti-Semitism masked as anti-Israel. Sometimes explicit, meaning someone says, I want to see Israel destroyed, but in most cases, implicit. So these people are just bad people. And they are here in America, walking around in campuses, as you heard, and in other places, and they're using the platform of anti-Israel to actually drive an anti-Semitic discourse that this country hasn't seen in decades. And it's happening on campus. What we're seeing today in some campuses against Jewish students would have been unthinkable 6-10 years ago. And it's happening now. So from the perspective of Netanyahu, how many successful BDS motions is right? But from the perspective of the BDS motions as platform for modern-day anti-Semitism here on campus, big problem. Second thing that Netanyahu cannot measure and doesn't see, and no one knows, is what we call the quiet boycotts.
The quiet?
Quiet boycotts. Okay? These are companies that boycott Israeli products. By the way, most of them, not because they don't like Israel, they just don't want to get in trouble.
Right.
So there are a lot of effects of that, and you know, South Africans will tell you, there's no emotion. So in 85, 86, most people didn't think that the regime was going to collapse, right? In 86.
We were in this one in 86.
So one of the big moments was the boycott on South African sports.
Rugby,
it's all about, right? Everyone in the Olympics and so on. There is now a motion to compromise Israel's membership in FIBA, soccer. It was defeated and they're bringing it back again. What I'm saying is that it's very pernicious, this whole thing of BDS. I think it's a real challenge. But let me just say two things. First, we do not believe, because of the motivations of those that are driving the delegitimization movement and the BDS movement, the anti-Israel movement, even if we have a comprehensive peace treaty with the Palestinians tomorrow, it's not going to disappear. They have a phenomenon that we call convergence, which means they converge around outstanding issues. We anticipate that they will immediately converge around internal issues within Israel proper, primarily the status of Israeli Arabs and the Bedouins in the Negev. Second thing is, so when we say that, we meaning our team, we've done a lot of research on it. In case you're wondering where all these ideas were coming from. So when we say that, you know, the right wing claps, the right wing is very happy. There is the second side of the argument. That ending the control over the Palestinian population is vital for blocking the spread of BDS into liberal and progressive circles. And without that, it's going to be very, very difficult. We're seeing now that the fastest growing group of people that support ideas and actions of BDS is among liberal progressive circles. Many of them are Jews. In more and more situations on campus today, a BDS fight is Jews against Jews. And this is where a credible and consistent commitment of the government to Israel to ending the control over the Palestinian population is vital. I'm not saying...
You had a question and then you had a question. People wanted to ask about the nation.
Yeah, so I think we should do two or three questions together.
You package it nicely.
Okay, so you wanted to hear...
No, that was just related to what we were talking about. Israel as a Jewish state. Do you think that's important?
That's why we're here for.
You had a question, maybe we'll take a couple of questions and then you can answer.
I just want to say that Andrew Kaufman, now lives here in the Bay Area. We created a team in Israel that began to design Birthright. Birthright was just an idea, a 20 words idea by an Israeli politician by the name of Yossi Beirin. And I asked Yossi Beirin for the mandate. He gave me the mandate to build the Israeli team. It started basically creating a strategy to implement Birthright. And then after about a year and a half of working, person by the name of Avram Infeld, South Africa too, said Birthright cannot be an Israeli project.
Right.
It has to be a partnership. So a few months later, I had my first, first professional visit to America, and we met a group, Kinsey-based group, and Andrew was part of this group. And from March 97 to March 99, together we designed Birthright, basically as you know in the Milan.
What's the source of funding for
Birthright?
Philanthropists,
government, and communities.
Good question.
Yes.
Good to see you.
Good to see you.
So I'm going to make a little bit of a provocative statement, and I'm hoping you're going to react. I think one of the other things that this JCC talks about is that we need a new Jewish future, and we need to get to the architect here of all places. And we all think that that's crazy, but I can make the argument why that's absolutely the case. We've talked about that for a long time. But to me, everything we're talking about here, the Knesset vote, the rabbinate, is all a function of pressures on organized religion, purity. To me, this is not about the Palestinians. The rabbinate, think about the disintermediation of the rabbinate that is going to happen in the world in the next 10 years. It's, what am I going to be a rabbi for when I have all my rabbis on the line? Why do I need to go to a local rabbi? So to me, the question is not how are Israel and the Jews and the diaspora going to work together. It's what is Jewish life going to look like? And then we can solve all these other things.
So,
and I'll just add on the BDS, every Jewish kid who fights over the BDS is having an issue in the back of their mind of, well, is this really worth the fight for? Why do I care so much about being Jewish? Why do I care so much about the Jewish state? Because they're being bombarded with anti-religious concepts all the time. And I think that's what makes it much harder for them to fight the Palestinian argument next door.
So let me just relate to that. For some people, the relevant avatar of a Jew is a Christian and a Muslim. Right? So for these people, they see Judaism through the religious story. But for many Israelis, the relevant other Jew is an Arab, a French, a Russian, right? So that means that we see Judaism through the prism of peoplehood or through the prism of nationhood. And that just shows you how powerful, I spoke earlier about these founding stories of Judaism, Tikkun Olam, nationhood, peoplehood, religion. And just from your question, we can see the difference. Now, to your question, I think that without a sovereign space where Jews exercise the right, their collective right to self-determination, we are just crippled and compromised. The only way for the Jewish people to be whole, okay, is to have a sovereign space, a space where we exercise our sovereignty. Now, I deeply believe that the state of Israel cannot be in a condition where we are disrespectful of the rights of other people in the long term. I'm not talking about the present conditions. And by the way, I don't like the frame 50 years of occupation, because I think that you really until 1988, 1991, 1993, so let's say between 88 and 1993, the proposition of the Palestinians was, if we get out of the West Bank, they will use this territory to destroy us. That was called the phase plan. Things really change, may have changed, some people doubt even that, as of the 1990s. And really, as of 2008, and some people will say maybe as of 2014, okay? I'm not getting into the timeline because this timeline is complicated and it's not relevant for today. What I'm saying is that I believe that Israel should be Jewish because it's democratic. And in order to do that, we have to ensure that in Israel we have sovereign Jewish majority. Okay? If the majority of the population in Israel is Jewish, then if you have a democracy, the country will be Jewish. Now, I've been living in America for a year and a half. For me, America is largely a Christian country. Christmas is a national, no one works on Christmas. Government doesn't work on Christmas. Okay? There's no full separation between church and state here.
Right.
Jewish holidays, everybody works. Christian holidays, people don't work.
Right.
And I can give you many other examples. The point is, when the vast majority of Israelis are Jewish, it's not really a point of tension. Then what we really need to do is we need to respect the rights of the minority, their way of life, their culture, and so on. And this is where we can also be benevolent, and we can be generous, as we should be, because it's the one statement that, that repeats itself in the Torah more than any other statement, even now in the parshas of this week, when Moses departs from the people of Israel, parting words, societal inheritance for 35 centuries into the future. That's what we need to remember. But if we're in a condition of majority, and by the way, I am a secular atheist Israeli, okay? Not coming from a religious perspective. The moment you have this condition of sovereign Jewish majority, you can have a Jewish state which is, comes out of it democracy. The moment we lose the majority, what happens is we will have to preserve our immunities and privileges through the use of force. And fundamentally, that will create a tension between being a Jewish state, in the sense of a state that belongs to the Jewish people, and the character of the state.
We have 5 minutes?
We have 5 minutes. We'll squeeze in. You have raised your hand before.
Yeah. I'm wondering, because metaphors have come up several times today, so there's a physics metaphor, or almost a gravitational one, which is that there's something that has heavy gravitational pull and continues to pull on something else. So I don't know whether you could consider Israel to be the sun in this case, and the U.S. to be one of the orbiting planets of the other one. There's another model, you know, which I think has a longer-term survival, which is biologic. So in that model, it turns out if you concentrate too much stuff, if you over, you know, farm any, you know, monoculture, you will eventually kill it. And in that model, the whole idea of diversity, which is the, you know, part of the problem that I'm seeing not only in Israel but in the U.S., is everything becomes so binary that there is no diversity in the middle. And the only way you end up saying, I'm right and they're wrong, is to affiliate yourself.
My favorite metaphor for describing Jewish people is ecosystem.
So my question is, given that, if that's true, and that's a model that I think we all know tends to long outlast a lot of the other models that are there, then how might that change the way we think about what it means to be Jewish now, you know, both here and there and anywhere else in terms of this affiliation?
So I think if you look at Mother Nature as a metaphor, by the way, I believe that the most relevant metaphor to describe the Jewish people is an ecosystem.
Yeah, that's
a permanently evolving ecosystem,
right.
Permanently evolving civilization. Every ecosystem, successful ecosystem, is basically a small-scale network, which means there are a lot
right.
of small units that are competing all the time. It's the free market.
Right.
Biodiversity.
Yeah, absolutely.
That has been the fundamental condition of the Jewish people forever. Forever. It's not new. So Hanukkah, what is Hanukkah? It's between the Hellenizing Jews
right.
and the Orthodox Jews.
Right.
And everything in between. Even now, in the Parsha of the week, what is Moses speaking about? Speaking about the potential of assimilation. When they get into the land of Israel, they will embrace foreign gods. So we've always had a spectrum from the very religious and committed people to the secular and so on. And that biodiversity is essential for our survival. That actually connects to Andrew's earlier question. Because we are basically a flat network of many, a flat small scale network, that network could potentially be led from anywhere.
Right, exactly.
From anywhere. Which means that this community can lead the Jewish world. That requires really deep leadership, a lot of thinking. But this community can lead the Jewish world.
You mean the North American Jewish community?
I'm sorry?
What community are you speaking about?
Here, Bay Area community.
Because it's also not just the Bay Area community. It's now also Israelis who live in the Bay Area community as
that
well.
Too. That too. But the point is that there could be leadership that will emanate from this community across the Jewish world.
Yeah.
It's possible, but it depends on the quality of the leadership here, the quality of the institutions that you will build, the amount of money that you will raise. There was nothing that predetermined that Lithuania,
right,
okay, will create a school of Jewish life and thought that will echo
right.
in our history for now almost two centuries. And many South African Jews are Lithuanian Jews.
Yeah.
And if you ask yourself, okay, how is it that South African Jews are so disproportionately represented in the leadership of Jewish communities all over the world, there is a history to that that goes back to Lithuania.
Fascinating.
Okay? My point
is... So you're saying the Jewish center doesn't have to be in Jerusalem?
No, that was my point. If it's thought about that...
The religious answer is yes.
Communal.
Jerusalem is the center.
Yeah.
The communal answer is Jewish leadership can emanate from anywhere
right.
and everywhere. It emanated from Cordoba, it emanated from Alexandria, it emanated from Warsaw, from Vilna, from Berlin, from London. Okay, let me give you a modern day example. Limud. Do you know, have you heard about the program Limud?
Sure, we have it here.
Limud. What is Limud? Started 20 something years ago in London, by the British Jewish community, not really in London, but by London Jews, and it's now all over the world. Okay? Limud are this opportunity, it's basically a movement today.
It's a community learning movement.
I would say it used to be a conference, now it's a movement.
Yeah.
All over the world of basically Jewish learning that is done in a
right.
very open and democratic way, a pluralistic way, where Lipson, the chief rabbi of England that used to not boycott. Ignore.
Right.
He didn't endorse. Okay? Limud. A few years later, endorsed Limud. From the highest authority of the person that I think is the most remarkable Jewish intellectual of our time, Lord Rabbi Jonathan Sacks.
Right.
Second to none this person today in the world. And he endorsed Limud, you know? It's a very big deal.
We have one more question. It's also really fascinating, but I need to make sure we have some time.
Very quick question, because we're running out of time.
Yeah.
Going back to the whole idea of the shifting centers or epicenters of Jewish life and the duality between the U.S. and Israel, one thing that's really important to point out is that there are hundreds of thousands of Israelis in North America, in the U.S. probably 5 to 7% of the population, higher here, higher in New York, higher in Boston, higher in Seattle. What are your thoughts about the role that Israelis living in the U.S. can have
Fantastic.
To revitalize the secular community?
Any other questions before we finish?
I would try also to ask about your comparison of separation of, let's call it church and state,
religion
and state, let's call it. In the United States, I come as, I'm an Israeli, Israeli-American citizen too, and I see here how we respect here any Jewish life, we respect any Orthodox, life, we go with pride, even if we are basically secular in our general life, we respectfully go sometime to service, high holiday, and so on. In Israel, if you are not Orthodox, you despise religion. Why can't we just build a separation
that we can get that? How do you preserve the majority?
In Israel?
Okay. How do you preserve the majority?
The question was talking about the spectrum. Why is the spectrum in Orthodox schools in which even the atheist can be a Jew? Because now I have this trouble with my grandchildren, 9 and 7, who don't want to have anything about Judaism because they don't believe in God. And I'm having a hard question. So I thought about the four questions of Seder and say that event that they didn't have yet a fifth child who asked, who was the scientist. And they had to explain God in terms of science. So you can still be a Jew, you can still be a scientist, you can still believe that God doesn't exist in the bare heart, you want to feel it is. And I think it could start with schools being more open and having the spectrum and thinking it's just about the Jewish holistic spectrum. Like that poem that said, I drew a circle and he took me out. It was heretic. Something he took me out, but I had with God and I had a week to draw a circle and put him in. So we ourselves are, I'm a convert. So I could not go to the Mexican synagogues because I'm out. But I am Sephardic descent. So the only one who converted me were the American synagogue. So I'm out in my country.
So let me actually relate to that. These are a few big questions. How much time do you have?
-5 minutes.
Okay. First of all, I just want to say that the question of who's a Jew, who's a member of the community, has been a big question forever. And there was never one answer, or multiple answers. And especially when it comes to people who are converting, there was always a doorway in one place, which may have been blocked in another place. It's not me. But even going back to the story of Shavuot, we believe the truth. It said it is written that Ruth said, "Amech ami Eloich Eloai," which means your people is my people, your God is my God. Which means she preceded peoplehood to nation. In English, you say convert. Ger, you convert in, you convert out. In Hebrew, we say ger, the gayer. In Shon Lagu, the language of peoplehood, the language of Hebrew. It's peoplehood language, okay? You have to want to be part of the community. The language of English is conversion, is religious language, okay? You convert in and out of the religion. I'm just using this, not to give you a personal answer because I don't know the personal case, just to show you it's a very complicated case and it's perfect, it's a very complicated field. And it's perfectly expectable that there would be some rabbis who will convert you and others that would not. The second thing is, you mentioned you're a Sephardic. Look, the whole story of the Anusim, the Maranos, huge story in our history, huge. A quarter of the Spanish population of today and 50% of the Portuguese population of today is considered to be descendants of Maranos.
Right.
Which means that the vast majority of Jews, when given the opportunity to convert or to leave, they converted. Okay?
Yes.
If you want to address the Israelis. For many, many years, we had this very, very polarized view, Israel and diaspora, Olim and Yehudim, etc., etc. I believe that this view today is irrelevant. We're living in a life of life cycle of movement. I'm, for example, for this third time in my adult life, spending a significant time in America. A year, another year, and now already a year and a half. So we move back and forth. That's perfectly healthy. I think that this community is vitally important, A, for the Jewish community here, for its connection with Israel, for the Jews in Israel, for Israel to understand diaspora Jews, because if there is a crisis of distancing, I think the bigger responsibility in this crisis is in Israel. Okay, so the understanding of diaspora Jews and so on, crucially important. And I think that one of the most important and fastest growing movements in the Jewish world today is the movement of the Israeli diaspora. In America, it's called the IAC, the Israeli American Council. I happen to have met them when they were the ILC, Israel Leadership Council. And there is a huge difference between the ILC and IAC. Because in IAC, the American is the noun and the Israeli is the adjective. Which means it's a movement that appreciates the fact that it's a movement of immigrants. They're no longer playing ostrich to the you know, acting as if they're here temporarily. They're Americans, Israeli Americans. And that means that there are also Italian Americans and Spanish Americans, there are Israeli Americans and there are Jews. Once you've gone, you've passed this threshold, the next key point to understand is that Israeli Americans can only sustain their identity as members of the Jewish community. Until a few years ago, there was separation. Already, I would say 8 years ago, when our team began to work on this issue in Reu, this place specifically, this institution, was one of the most remarkable institutions of integration between Israelis and American Jews. Already here, 8 years ago, and we saw this as one of the five outstanding locations in America.
You're talking about on this Palo Alto Institute?
Yes.
Palo Alto.
This room.
Can I just say
one last sentence.
Look, people ask, you ask, why be Jewish? And it's a big question, why be Jewish? My answer today, 21st century, is that being Jewish allows you the opportunity to be part of a people that is deeply committed to making this world a better place. Okay? This is the biggest proposition, I think, that the Jewish people gives Jews today. It's an opportunity to have a stake, to be a stakeholder in an enterprise whose mission is to make the world a better place, especially when the world is in such a crisis. And we have done it in the past multiple times, and I think there's no reason to assume we won't be able to do it in the future. And this is the big opportunity. And also, as Jews and as Israelis, the number of practical opportunities that we have to be part of something that is so much bigger than ourselves is basically, I believe, second to none.
Yep.
I roam around America, because of my work, I get to do it, I roam around Israel. The amount of talent per square foot of people engaged in making the world a better place is unbelievable in Israel, especially compared to America. If it was an equal number on a per capita basis of Americans or Europeans dedicated to making this world a better place, the world would be much
better place.
Thank you.
Wonderful.